Good afternoon, everybody. In spite of what it says up there, I'm not Elliott Visconsi, but I'm Peter Holland, the Associate Dean for the Arts in the College of Arts and Letters, and welcome to Saturday Scholars. I'll introduce Elliott in a moment, but may I just mention the upcoming Saturday Scholars between now and the end of the season. Next Saturday, Celia Dean Drummond, who's a professor in the Department of Theology, is going to be talking about evolution, humans, and other animals, theology and anthropology in dialogue. On the 15th of November, the Northwestern game, we're going to return to the question about what happens in the new digital world when Matthew Wilkins, who's an assistant professor in the Department of English, is going to give an answer to the question he's posed, what's all the fuss about digital humanities? And our last Saturday Scholars of this season will be on the 22nd of November, the Louisville game, and John Duffy, who runs the university's writing program, is going to talk about beyond civility, addressing the crisis in American public discourse. And I think he's right, it is a crisis. So let me introduce Elliott Visconsi, who is today's speaker. Elliott is an associate professor of English in the English department, and he's also, unusually, a concurrent associate professor in the law school. People who cross-link across to the law school are not common in Notre Dame structures. But the reason why we invited him to speak to us today is that he serves as Notre Dame's first ever chief academic digital officer. And he directs a brand new department office on campus, the Office of Digital Learning. His job in that area is to develop a university-wide digital strategy, supporting courses with digital resources, helping instructors to find new modes of delivering their work, and students with new modes of learning, and to try to promote faculty, student, and staff engagement with the new learning technologies. It's only 4 years since Elliott joined the Notre Dame faculty. He came here in 2010. And since he arrived here, he's also founded a company called Luminary Digital Media. And the first major project for Luminary was to create, with his co-founder, Catherine Rowe, who used to be at Bryn Mawr and is now the Provost of Smith College, an iPad app for Shakespeare's play, The Tempest. It's designed to provide an easy and very much interactive access to one of Shakespeare's most famous plays. The Luminary app for The Tempest got a lot of attention from publications like The Atlantic, US News and World Report, and even the South Bend Tribune, and I'm happy to say that there are many more Luminary Shakespeare apps on their way. The Tempest app merged Elliott's interest and expertise in digital media with his own otherwise more traditional research and teaching interests in literature, law, and political thought in the early modern period, both in England and in the Americas. He teaches an extremely successful course on contemporary First Amendment doctrine, and he also worries at and worries about with his students the future of free expression in the digital age. Let me welcome, on your behalf, Elliott Visconsi. Thank you.
Thank you. What a lovely introduction, Peter. Thanks very much. Can you guys hear me okay? So it is true that I found my way into this digital domain by trying to solve a teaching problem, which is to say, how do we lower the entry cost for Shakespeare? I'm not a developer, a computer scientist. I got into the world of digital teaching and learning and the possibilities there by confronting a very traditional problem, which is to say, let's take something hard and make it a little bit easier so that then when our students enter class, they're further down the spectrum. So on a spectrum of 0 to 100, they start in class at 30 instead of at 10, right? I mean, it's a sort of classic flipped classroom model. So there are now actually 6 Luminary products out in the market, the top 5 Shakespeare plays in addition to The Tempest. It's been a real pleasure. And I think one of the things I want to talk about today, just to be really clear, I'm going to try and move things along really quickly so that we can get to Q&A, which I always regard as the most engaging and exciting part of this for all of us. So my goal today is to give us a shared vocabulary. Part of what we're doing here at Notre Dame this week, as we have a program called Digital Week, which kicked off yesterday with a lecture by Anant Agarwal, who's here in the audience today, who's the CEO of edX and one of the great transformative figures in higher education, speaking and working today. Thanks for coming, Anant, this morning. What we're trying to do is create a shared vocabulary. And so I'm going to lay out some principles, talk a little bit about where I see higher education evolving, what some of the principles, shared principles and shared vocabulary looks like, and then finally what Notre Dame is going to be doing, and then hopefully we'll get to the Q&A really quickly. So that's my plan of attack. So the first section, what is online learning, and AKA, what does it mean to live in a digital age? So I'm going to ask a question that I start my First Amendment class often with: where is the public square? Anybody want to venture an answer? Where is the public forum right now, 2014?
In the cloud.
What do you mean?
Well, it's a term I've heard. I'm not sure exactly what it means other than there's this information that's accessible to anybody on the globe.
Okay, so there's servers, there's big server farms all over the world where we get access to information almost immediately. Okay, anybody else? Where's the public forum? Where does speech happen? Another way to put it, where does our speech happen?
Blogs.
And blogs. Okay, that's an express, you know, one modality. Where else?
Social media.
Okay, and social media. Where else? How much of our speech as citizens, how much of our speech as citizens happens in a newspaper, printed newspaper, or in a rally in the public square? Not so much anymore. Most of our speech, most of our communications is digitally mediated. The public square, the public forum, that place where we imagine citizens meeting together to deliberate in the marketplace of ideas about which ideas do we want to invest in as a polity, right, has moved into the digital domain. Primarily, most of our communications are now in the cloud, on social media, web publishing, and so forth, right? And so one of the consequences, right, of that move is to ask us to think about a whole new set of questions. Okay, so these things are happening in the cloud. Who owns the cloud? Amazon, Google, a lot of other server companies, right? And so there's an invisible intermediary helping us communicate with each other, sometimes visible, sometimes invisible, but that asks us to think about a whole different set of questions about freedom of expression and about the nature of community, right? If we have an intermediary helping us to argue about, for example, what what human flourishing is and ought to be, how it ought to be expressed in political form, and so on. So where is the public sphere? Where does public discussion happen? It happens chiefly in the digital domain. It's not to say it doesn't happen in real life by any means, right? But our sort of primary medium now for communication and for expression is digital, right? And that has profound implications for education. So in the last 10 to 20 years, there have been a couple of moves that have been quite important and significant in terms of the way we think about ideas and communication. And there's a phrase that Nicholas Negroponte from MIT coined in 1995, very much ahead of the curve, which he called digitality. And the idea of digitality is that sense that the ubiquity of communication, the habits of mind that come from having easy and immediate and often free access to information, to communication, to communicate on the global scale almost effortlessly, that's a pretty radical transformation, not only in the velocity of information and the access to information, but also in the way that we imagine ourselves as speakers on the world stage. So it brings with it some cognitive habits. We've also witnessed in the past 20 years a profound media shift. That is to say, before the 1990s, before the advent of the internet revolution, right, the cost of speaking was quite high. If I had an idea and I wanted to communicate, I had to go and work in the newspaper or find a TV station that would sell me some advertising to, and so forth. So there was a very, the model was, as Clay Shirky describes it, filter then publish. It's expensive to speak, so you have to actually make sure you curate very carefully, if you're the radio or the newspaper or what have you, the messages you get out. It's expensive to speak, you filter content, and then you publish. Now we flipped that, Web 2.0, in particular in the rise of the internet. Publish then filter is the new model. Everyone can speak at any time to anyone on blogs and social media and so forth. And for that reason, we can all speak now, and potentially we can reach more people in Indonesia or in Russia or in South Bend or wherever. We can potentially reach more people than ever before virtually effortlessly, as long as you have an internet connection. Again, that creates a number of really profound habits of mind, and it does have implications for education, particularly online education. Okay? So we'll talk about that a little bit. So we have that sense of the changing, you know, the information ecosystem we inhabit, both as citizens, as individuals, but also as universities, has been profoundly transformed by the internet. And that comes with both good and bad features. In the last few years, in particular, the rise of the cloud is very significant. The rise of high-quality broadband, the ability to stream video to massive numbers around the world has had a profound, has unlocked profoundly what we as educational institutions can do, how we can address hundreds of thousands of learners in Indonesia or in Indiana or in Canada, wherever we find them, around the globe. So there's been, in the last 3 to 5 years, in the domain of information architecture, cloud-based computing, and so forth, we've seen, and the triumph, as it were, of mobile devices, smartphones, and so on, we've seen a really profound infrastructural change in what is possible. And higher education institutions are then starting to address that through things like the edX Consortium and other sort of platforms to say, how can we, as universities, contribute to human flourishing through education? How can we, as universities, give our students and faculty and staff the best possible experience, the highest quality experience on campus? How can we research and understand what works to teach students, to give them a better experience, more retention and more mastery sooner in a more flexible format? How can we address all of those questions? And an outfit like edX has really been leading the way in teeing up those three questions and seeing those as mutually dependent on each other rather than competitive with each other. We can improve teaching and learning here at Notre Dame even as we address educational content to learners all around the world and give it to them for free. So we have also some other things that we want to think about. If you think about higher education, why do we have 50-minute classes? Does anybody know? Maybe, okay, that's actually an optimistic answer. Why else? Why do we have 50-minute lectures or 75-minute lectures?
Carnegie units,
which is what?
Per credits.
So it's a measure of credits, so we know how much contact time. Any other reasons? Why would we have 50 or 75 minute class?
To give you time to walk to your next class.
Okay, so why not 60 minutes, right? So it has mostly to do, as with many other structures, with administrative convenience. So we can get more classes into the rooms that we have, right? It's primarily, you know, class lengths and so on are primarily an administrative convenience in order to leverage the available space. Right? It's nothing to do with pedagogy, or not in its origins, never had anything to do with the best pedagogies. Right? It was an administrative convenience. So someone said, how many classes can we get into this room? Well, if we have them in 50 minutes, that's long enough to be substantive, but we can get 8 classes in here. But if we have 180-minute classes, it might be better pedagogically, but we can only use it twice. So you have an administrative rather than a pedagogical or instructional decision being made. And there's all kinds of versions of that, including things like the semester. All kinds of versions of that which are primarily administrative conveniences related to non-pedagogical, non-instructional rationales that universities are now starting to understand that we can actually break up those units and we can do more. We have the ability to be more creative. And so finally, one of the core things that I think is that we have in our grasp right now, right, is the sense to say we don't need to throw out what we've always done. We can use old and established pedagogies as we have done. I give my own personal experience with that. The software that Peter was talking about was designed to do a very, very traditional style of teaching, which is teach a reader who has little experience how to close read Shakespeare, how to dig in and understand at the sentence level, how to understand emphasis, and how to master something, which is difficult. It's a very old-fashioned way of, you know, it's an old pedagogical problem, and there's old habits, and it's been part of the way that humanist instruction happens for a long time. So we took an old existing pedagogy and put it into a new platform, the mobile device, the iPad, right, to try and solve some problems for people, right? So, and I think that's a lot of what's happening right now is that we're taking old pedagogies. There's a lot of new creative pedagogies emerging, but there's old pedagogies being enabled by new platforms, as well as, of course, new styles of teaching which are emerging, which were never possible before. So it's not, it's everything is not radical and new, I guess I should say. There's a common vocabulary that I want to establish in some fundamental ways. So we have, there's a variety of different versions of online and digitally enhanced instruction. One is the fully online course. Another is the course module, a three-week module, which doesn't resemble a traditional quarter or semester length course, but nonetheless has a kind of integrity to itself, right? It is a whole unit, a three-week or four-week module. And that's maybe taught fully online. We also have, as was mentioned, MOOCs, which you've heard a lot about, no doubt, massive open online courses. This is free instructional courseware of the kind that edX, Coursera, and other companies are helping universities to facilitate. These are courses which are designed to increase access to education on the world scale. And you can see a profound impact. There are hundreds and thousands of stories of learners who didn't have access to information, whether they be in Mongolia or in Ecuador or in South Bend, who got access to an education simply by having internet access. And they got some, you know, some life skills, some education, and so forth. And that's crucial to any sense of university's mission, to contribute to human flourishing. There's the flipped classroom, the hybrid and blended. We've probably heard a lot about flipped and hybrid or blended learning. And these are cases when an instructor takes digital materials and creates an interactive, what you might call a next generation textbook video and assessments and lessons and homeworks and so on, puts that into an online platform, and that becomes the out of class experience, which then allows us in a classroom like this to do more, to go deeper into problem solving, to have a better quality of contact time, right? So if I did nothing for the rest of this presentation but talk at you, it would be a lot less interactive than if we, for example, got to the questions sooner than later. So I'll keep moving quickly. We also have learning analytics. These platforms throw off a lot of data about how students are progressing, how students are starting to master concepts and where they're struggling. And as instructors, that feedback, that insight into where students are learning or where they're struggling is crucial to help us understand how we can help, how we can be more effective in our jobs. Ultimately, all of these tools are a great opportunity for us to improve the quality of education here on campus at Notre Dame, in the United States, in colleges and universities, and around the world. They're an opportunity for us to be more intentional, more creative, and more effective in our teaching and learning, which is a core, right, offering that we as universities give to our families, our students, and learners around the world. And so we take that very seriously as an opportunity to get better, continuously be iteratively improving on what works and making sure we're serving our students as best we can. So there are many great affordances. Why do this? I've articulated some of these already. Better learning has to be the number one goal. Deeper learning, getting further into the curriculum. Access to education, the human rights argument, which I take really seriously. Again, detailed student analytics, enhanced creativity, unbundling and flexibility in certification, thinking a little bit more creatively about the ways in which we as a university can understand where our students are and give them opportunities to advance further into the curriculum. So to use summers effectively, to use open online courses, not as necessarily as credit-bearing instruments, but as means to advance placement as a short-term solution. And also, of course, visibility and presence on a global stage. We, Notre Dame, are well known. We have a pretty broad global footprint. We'd like to be well known. We'd like to be even more well known and to have some of that visibility and presence have a deep academic and educational outreach component, right? It's been very hard to do that until the last few years for all the technological reasons I pointed out. So now we can connect with our students in a really, in a much deeper and more academically serious way than was physically possible prior to now. So that's one of the, you know, it's one of the great affordances for a university. So some people have said, why not, what are the concerns? And one has to always be clear about what the concerns are when you look at new sort of ventures and so on. Is academic integrity and identity verification the same as on campus? Doesn't quite match right now. There are more and less concerns around that area depending on fields and what you're trying to do, but these are areas that are being addressed. The erosion of the classroom experience, many people say, I want to preserve the classroom experience. And what I would say to that is absolutely. Classroom experience, the in-person experience, is very important. What we think we can do with online and digital tools is improve the quality of what happens in class, right? And get students more of what they came for. And there's some stuff which we can give them, they can get to it remotely and then get into classes or get into their residential experiences with much greater impact on their life. So they're not doing as much, perhaps, introductory coursework and so on. IP concerns, anything you put on the internet is potentially vulnerable to piracy. One always has to be clear about that. Cost and production. It's not inexpensive to create fully online courses or course modules and so on, and so we don't want to pass that bill on to our families and students if we can avoid that. So that was the sort of the brief tour of common vocabulary. What is higher education going to look like in 2020? Important question for us here at Notre Dame, but around, you know, throughout the sector. I wanted to put up some bullet points from Howard Gardner, who's a person who I admire a lot as an educational psychologist of great distinction, and who has articulated some of the values of liberal education and the residential university model. And these values are not in any way, right, competitive with the possibilities that online learning presents to us, right? And I'll talk about that more in a moment. Liberal education is Gardner says, the creation and maintenance of a community that embodies the best of human values. One learns an academic discipline and creates new knowledge within the frameworks, norms, and protocols of a discipline, right? You learn to understand what it means to be an English major, or a finance major, or a biologist, and so on. You learn an academic discipline, which in itself has integrity and a long history of creating knowledge. Command a series of disciplines to think across fields synthetically, to be fully formed as a, you know, in the liberal arts model, fully formed rather than simply reading one subject, whether it be English or computer science and so forth. Now, live in proximity to and learn from peers engaged in the same journey, deep personal engagement with teachers. Right? Some might say, wait a minute, that you don't get that online. Right? Fully online, you get some personal engagement. You may not live in proximity. You get a different kind of personal engagement, and often it's a very high quality sense of personal engagement. Right? But all of this, if you think about this menu of options, right? If we do a great job of building online and digital tools, we can enhance, right, all of these propositions because we can do more in class, right, to get more personal engagement by using smart things out of class, by using online and digital tools out of class. And we could talk more about that. Higher education is under pressure, as everybody, I think, will acknowledge. The cost of undergraduate tuition, this fairly alarming graph. This is the CPI down here. College textbook prices, which have skyrocketed almost exactly in parallel to the cost of college tuition. The big upward curve starts in about 2000 and just races up high. So that's a difficult picture. We need to be clear about addressing the cost picture, both for textbooks, but also the cost of undergraduate tuition. We're also, if you think about, maybe not so much at Notre Dame, but higher education globally is under an enormous amount of pressure. In India or in China or in, you know, actually in large, you know, state systems in the United States, the capacity to serve students, right, is nowhere near what it needs to be to meet the demand. There's thousands, tens of thousands, hundreds of thousands of highly qualified, talented learners in India alone who don't have a place in any of the recognized higher education institutions for reasons of capacity. There just isn't the capacity. So online learning can start to address that as a potential solution, right? To start to help with some of the scale and capacity questions. And if we believe that education is crucial to human flourishing, this is a good thing, right? Some other pressures on higher education, opportunity costs. It's very difficult for someone in their mid-20s or early 30s who's in a successful or thriving career to jump and take 2 or 3 years to go and get a graduate and professional degree, right? To go to law school, for example, right? If you're already on the, if you're already embedded in a career that you're enjoying, or to get an MBA and so on. So there's pressure on those kind of degrees. So can we help by taking some of that instruction at the graduate and professional level online to increase some flexibility while we're also preserving the campus, the character of the campus experience? I think we can do that. Also alternative credentialing, which is another thing we can talk about in the Q&A. So there's a lot of pressure for people to say, give me mastery-based credentialing, let me have, let me have credit for demonstrating my mastery as opposed to sitting in this or that class, and we have to be really careful about how we address that. A lot of pressures. Higher education is very much under pressure. There's a couple of institutions here. Everybody feels that pressure differently. The ROI questions, return on investment questions, are not going away. Right? Why should I, either a student or as a family, pay $60,000 a year for this education? I believe in the value of what we offer here at Notre Dame. I believe in what the value is of that for many other institutions. But this is a question that, as the price continues to go up, we're going to need to have a fantastic answer to that question. Right? Those questions are not going away, and political pressures around the cost of tuition and attendance will continue to mount. Right? What I would say about this, I think there's going to be radical segmentation, and that the experience as between these different categories, flagship publics, I did my PhD at UCLA, flagship publics, the University of California, IU, the experience at the flagship publics with 35 or 40,000 undergraduates or 50,000 undergraduates is going to become substantially different from what we can offer at Notre Dame or at MIT. We have 8,000 undergraduates, not 45,000. And so the quality of the offering, the quality of the experience is going to be different. And the gap between these, the styles of instruction, I believe, will get quite profound. Liberal arts, elite liberal arts colleges like Swarthmore, very small classes and so on, that's going to look a little bit different, I think. There are sectors where you might see fully online instruction for all kinds of reasons appropriate to the genre. And I think that community colleges, for example, where the residential experience is really not a key part of, in fact, not at a part of the offering typically, right? The students might say, I much prefer the online course because it fits into my work schedule or my busy schedule and so forth. So I think that you might see that community colleges are going fully online. And the place where I think there's probably the most anxiety right now is in the smaller regional colleges and universities, which have relatively small footprint, and I picked these two at random, but there's a lot more. St. Anselm College, a small Catholic college in New Hampshire, and Andrews University not far from here. I think the pressure there feels acute, right? And so there's going to be a pretty radical segmentation of the different styles of university, and we're already seeing that happen. So here are some of the ROI questions. If we can create better teaching at all levels, if we can profoundly transform and enhance the quality of teaching, even if there's segmentation between the styles of experience, if all of our institutions are working together and are benefiting from the advances in digital and online learning, right, the entire sector will thrive, right? If we do a better job teaching, if we are more effective, if we are more delivering the goods to transform young people's lives and deliver on the promise to be constantly, as a lifelong environment, constantly improving people's lives in the arc of their lives, not just from the age of 18 to 22, we're going to deliver the goods. Online courses certainly can help solve problems of scale, can reduce some of the costs of administration, of operating large 30 large sections of calculus and so forth. flipped and hybrid courses can unlock creativity and radically increase the quality of class time, the immersive and interactive pedagogies, and so on. And we can also offer people many expanded options in terms of curricular flexibility, enhanced catalogs, scheduling and sequencing, and so on. Okay, so what are we doing here at Notre Dame? We've joined the edX Consortium, which we can talk more about in the Q&A. We have an edX Consortium is, as was said, is a group of great, elite universities which have joined together with Professor Agarwal's vision, animated by Professor Agarwal's vision, to deliver on the human rights promise of access, but also, of course, to advance research and improve teaching on all of our campuses. So it very much is at the center of a strategy that we're unfolding. We've also created the Office of Digital Learning, which is a small organization here on campus. Our model is a partnership model. So what we do is we pick strategic targets. Some of it comes from faculty, a lot of it comes from us. We pick strategic targets where we can make a big difference on campus at Notre Dame, and we take that course and we give it the full digital treatment, which means we work with faculty as partners along with designers, media producers, programmers, and developers to build the tools that will deliver on the promise of the flipped or hybrid transformative model. Right? And so that means we're understanding that faculty cannot be expected to do this work on their own. Right? Because they often don't have, will be training themselves in, all these different literacies, which is very ineffective. Let's unlock professionals who know how to create good, effective short videos, who know how to do programming and development to build the tools that faculty need. So we certainly, as I say, we have more to say about the edX Consortium. I'll preview for you at this moment the courses that we're going to be running in our first wave, which will go live in late spring. Our first wave of open online courses, Enrichment for the World, and which we think will be especially attractive to our alumni and friends. We're going to be doing a theology sequence with some of our most outstanding instructors in theology, Gary Anderson, John Cavadini, and Gabriel Reynolds. We're going to be doing a team-taught course on wireless, and that's going to be team-taught by Nick Lanneman in electrical engineering, Aaron Strigel in computer science, Tricia Belia in law, and Barry Keating in finance. And so that will look at the technology, the economics, and the regulatory policy environment around wireless and mobile technologies. We'll be doing a course on math and sports with a focus on biomechanics, teaching math and some physical concepts through sports with Mike Hildreth, professor of physics, and Annette Pilkington, who's a professor in the math department. And we're going to be doing a course called Stats in Everyday Life, Statistics in Everyday Life, with Vice President, Associate Provost, and Professor of Sociology, Dan Myers. So I encourage you all to sign up for these courses as soon as we go live. They're going to be great. The Office of Digital Learning has some of these sort of remits. We study, we make, and we distribute. Right? We study what's best, we research it, we work with faculty to make the content, and we distribute the content, either on campus, with partners, or free and open for the world. So, what does Notre Dame look like in 2020? This is where I'm going to stop. What does Notre Dame look like in 2020? My simple goal, my personal goal, is that we are one of the handful of universities that is taking digital learning so seriously that we have world-class offerings here on campus. We expand the footprint of what's possible for our students and our stakeholders, leveraging our global gateways. And that we put ourselves on the posture of a studio. That is, we are creating content and distributing it according to our own goals. So whether we create a course and we give it to every Catholic high school in the country to help them in their own thriving and flourishing, right? Or we give away content to the world, we do it on our own terms. And that we become a studio author, right? That stays true to our vision and articulates the value of higher education in such a way that we can say we are one of the world's great universities and we are the great Catholic research university for the 20th century. So those are my goals. I'll stop there and we'll dive into Q&A. So thank you. Questions from the floor? Yes.
Can you sort of walk us through how you selected one of your first courses, what it was based on? Was it based on a compelling professor, subject matter you thought would work online? Was it based on the target audience we're trying to reach? And then can you also say how long it took from saying, okay, it's this course, this professor, to creating the online, and then what the cost was of doing that?
Well, we haven't created the, I've announced that in the last 36 hours. So the faculty committee just made those selections, and so we are going to get to work on Monday, starting the production process. So I can't answer the second part in terms of how long it took us and all of the rest.
Can you say how long you project to make it and how much you project that it will cost?
We are going to go live with these courses in a staggered way in late spring. So starting in October, it'll probably take us about, and they're short courses. They're 6 or so weeks. So it will probably take us up until the go-live time to finalize the production. The cost, we're not billing all of this out, and we're not doing a model in such a way that we're counting the hours of time internally, which means that we don't have to be billing internal units and so forth, right? So one of the reasons we put the team together in the way that we did, which is adding some core staff and then leveraging existing colleagues in OIT and elsewhere, was to say that we don't want to be counting dollars as we produce these courses, because we're going to be producing a lot of different kinds of content. The going rate, if you freelance this out for a 6 to 7 week course, is around between $75,000 and $100,000, right? But that implies a lot of ground floor basic development and hiring, a studio. If you don't have a studio, we have studios. We have studios coming. So that's that is for someone who has no resources and infrastructure and has to pay everybody out of pocket and so forth. So I think that we have all the pieces, and one of our challenges was creating an ecosystem on campus where we can leverage all those pieces so we don't have to go, and unless we want to find a freelancer who can do some specific thing for us. Does that answer your question? I mean, the way the courses were chosen was a combination. There was an RFP that was sent to the whole faculty. Faculty proposed courses. A faculty committee selected the courses that it felt would be of highest strategic value, would have the best chance of making an impact on campus at Notre Dame as well as in the world, and that represented our core strengths to the world. So those were, it was a combination of strategy and so on, but it was very much a faculty-driven process. Right. Other questions? Yep.
I have the understanding, very shallow, that individuals have a variety of different learning styles, and the auditorium,
sure,
the settings, and so forth. The 8 or 9 different categories are yep. sorted out. How does all that you're talking about, if you could tell the student has this learning style, then
yep.
this content would be presented in this way. And if a person had a different learning style, same content would be presented
right.
in a somewhat different way. Is that been part of this?
Well, there's a domain of this area called adaptive learning, which is to say the software starts to, it's a kind of a process where the software starts to understand how learners are interacting with the material and where they're succeeding, and then it will push to them suggestions about paths to take through the material. That's part of what is in the environment, right, in the digital learning environment, adaptive tools that really start to listen, as it were, and then push things. There's also learning analytics, which is to say data which is surfaced to the instructor, and it says, hey, this student is really struggling with these three operations in calculus, right? Look at the red flags here, here, and here, and here. And so then you can then, as the instructor, go in and start to address that, say, hey, I discovered you're really struggling with these operations. Here's a couple of tools. Maybe I'll push you a tutorial. Maybe actually come into office hours, and I'll work on with you for an hour how you master this operation, right? So rather than expecting the student to sit there and say, why am I struggling with this operation in silence, it gives the instructor the incentive and the possibility to go and say, I noticed this is happening. Come in and let me help you with it, right? And so it just creates a really positive feedback loop. And then there's a lot of other, there are many, many other possibilities. Video is a good example. If you have a video asset, a short 6-minute segment that is teaching you a core concept, you know, second law of thermodynamics or something, right? And you are a highly visual learner, that might be really effective. If it takes you, you need to have a transcript and you need to see the notes at the same time, and you can search and pause and renew them, then you've got that possibility there. And so it minimizes the differences as to who does best in this kind of format. Because if you have a little bit of a module there that you can renew, you can look at 6 times. And then you see the text and the notes and the transcript right next to it. That can help you, right? So it's potentially more, it has more capacity to meet learners where they are. But it's essentially a constant process. Yeah, go ahead.
Are any of the courses planned to be with any graded options? And very long term, is Notre Dame considering offering any online degrees?
Okay, so the first part, are the courses considered to be graded? We will, for the first wave, we will certainly do what's called the verified certificates. So that is to say, for a fee, you can opt in to get a certificate of completion and so forth. That's not the same as for credit offering, where we'll give you 3 Notre Dame credits. We don't contemplate that at this moment. We may think of other forms of alternative credentialing that are more portable. But that's not in prospect at this moment. For the open offering, right? For the scaled offering with 50,000 students taking theology and so forth, right? There are other ways to manage online courses. We have given credits for private, small online courses where we have a really clear sense of identity verification. We understand how exams and other instruments are being managed, and that's an evolving conversation. The second question was, so grades, and then what's the long term? Remind me.
Long term, if very long term, you're considering being able to get a degree online.
Degrees.
We are looking at, in the graduate and professional domain, certain very specific sectors where we might, with the college's enthusiasm, look at hybrid online degrees. But those would be at the graduate level, and those would be in very specific areas where there's a real need to address someone in a professional field, right? Something like business analytics and so on, where the opportunity cost, as was said, to come and move to South Bend, which is not a major metropolitan area, right? I mean, if we were in Northwestern, or if we were in Boston, or if we were in New York, there's a huge pool of people who can come, drive down the street and take these night courses and so on. We don't have the same metropolitan ecosystem. So we're looking at a very small number of graduate and professional degrees that would emerge from college and departmental interest that would then be pitched to learners who are in careers who want an additional credential. And anything we do in that space is in the current iteration, certain to have serious engagement with campus, even if it doesn't mean weekly engagement. So immersive experiences, so that any learner who gets a degree from Notre Dame will feel part of this community. That's really important. Yes?
I was just wondering, in the introductory courses that are going to be
debuting, yes, the EdX courses, yes.
Yeah. And you'll probably be teaching those to alums a great
absolutely
deal. Are you planning to have a cost for those?
No.
Is that an initial concept, and you will then someday have costs, or you don't know yet?
Well, no, I don't. I mean, if we're going to do something that is open, it's going to be open and free. That's not to say there won't be other opportunities within the course for people to get more services that they want that are optional.
And you may add on.
Right. So that's the freemium-premium model.
Right.
And I think that's actually that's okay, right? Because I mean, these things do. I mean, even though we're not counting these costs, these are real resources and real salaries I'm paying and so forth. So, developing this kind of work costs a lot of resources and a lot of time and so forth. So, but whatever we do, if we say it's open, it's going to be open. And it's going to be free because we believe that education is a human right. Right? Access to information, access to education, it's not the same as a degree. Access to education is a human right. So whatever we do, if it's going to be open, it's going to be free. Of course, as I say, there will be other options for people to say, I would also like these other services.
Return on investment. Oh, it's a regular.
Yeah.
Can you comment on how for-profit online educational institutions factor in to the conversation about online digital learning among traditional universities?
Great question. So the University of Phoenix model and others. And yeah, I think, and so Anand said this the other day, I think that, you know, the for-profits have a very different model, which is, you know, there are issues with predatory lending and there's issues with completion and so forth in the area, because the goal is primarily to return value to shareholders as opposed to delivering degrees to students and so forth. I think that, you know, a for-profit university has a different set of goals. It's not necessarily, I mean, it may be 100% teaching. It may not, it's not going to be a research institution and so forth. It addresses a different market. I think that universities are, by their nature, engines of creating knowledge and engines of pursuing truth and researching to, in the service of, you know, certainly of the private sector, but especially in the service of the sum total of human flourishing. That's part of, that's in our DNA, right? And so if we can offer more of what we do on our terms into the broader market, I think that'll make a big difference in terms of how we're working off campus as well as on campus. I mean, I don't want to lose sight of how important it is for us to do things off campus. Now, I should say, I'm not at all opposed to the idea of for-profit education. I mean, I have started a small company. For-profit educational services or textbook publishing. I mean, that is, we will make smart partnerships with companies. We'll make smart partnerships with for-profits because they offer us something of value and we can collaborate. Our incentives may be aligned. But as it applies to instruction, I think that as the nonprofit sector of higher education can and should, and now with the help of people like Anand Agarwal, is doing more, right, to improve the quality of teaching and learning. So yeah, thank you. I know there's one, yeah, in the back.
How do you think the digital age will affect classroom size? And in particular, I'm thinking of these freshman type classes where you have 200 people in the class, very yep. little interaction.
Yes.
Why wouldn't they always be better online?
You know, I think it's going to, I guess that I would go back to the question, it's a great question. I would go back to the point about segmentation. So if you look at the University of Florida or Tennessee or something big, 40,000, you might see intro psych or intro economics or you name it, will have 4,000, 3,000 students, right? Or maybe 1,000, I'll just be conservative. 1,000 students in intro psych, and they'll have one online super section. And then there might be, depending on the sort of the cost picture, there might be then some online tutorials, or I'm sorry, excuse me, there might be some in-persons and tutorials and things like that where there's some interaction. There's a lot of pressure, a lot of legislative pressure and a lot of cost pressure to go in that direction for those kind of institutions, right? If the course is a better course in that format than in a 1,000-person lecture hall, which, I mean, I kind of blows my mind, but there are these kind of courses, 1,500 students in a giant auditorium and so on. If the online course is a better course, is more personalized, is more effective, and so on, then I think those universities can and should do that.
But even in Notre Dame, I'm a freshman who has 200 kids in a couple classes.
There are some of those, and I think that for us, I mean, it's going to have to emerge from the use case, right? So that one of my goals is to find those larger courses and make, you know, that's the high impact opportunity. Organic chemistry or intro physics or whatever, right? And go and partner with the department chair and the faculty and say, we want to give this the full treatment because we know we can make a big difference for a lot of students here. Let's start by building this digital layer. And it'll allow your faculty to do more with that 200 student course. Maybe there's more breakout and there's more small group sessions. And then we can, you know, iterate on the process until we get to the sort of what feels right for the curriculum, in the department, and then and the university. Yes?
Will you, or do you think you might work with Khan Academy with the idea of mastery, where they have, you know, that students are going through using that, and then it's kind of like a video game where they have to master a concept so many times before they have to move on, which is a wonderful idea, mm-hmm. because then they're not going so fast.
Yeah, did you get access to my playbook or something before?
No, I'm just saying I like Khan Academy.
Yeah. Yeah. In fact, now for what it's worth, we're at an advanced level of conversations with Khan to build an onboarding course that will allow that would launch this summer. That will be about a 3-week online experience for incoming freshmen, which would be a math readiness course that would be non-graded, but would allow them to sort of flex their muscles as they're getting ready for Notre Dame, to identify some of the areas where they want to, you know, where they might need some, to build some mastery, so that when they hit the ground running, when they hit campus, they hit the ground running. And it's especially an acute issue in math readiness. So we're, no promises, but that, we're committed to doing that there, and Khan is committed to doing that, and that'll be a hybrid of some of their content and some of our content. So yes, so that's a strong yes.
When I was here, you know, but didn't come along to learn a lot, because you didn't even go to school here, you would learn a lot by all of the visitors, I think. Mm-hmm. Is it possible that they'll take some of that and put it online for the alumni or others, mm-hmm. that they should have the benefit of seeing some of those things?
Yes, and we've already done some of that. So Anand Agarwal, who's right behind you, his lecture was live streamed to the web yesterday. And the alumni office has an online learning portal where they do a lot of this kind of content of sharing with alumni and friends some of the great stuff that's happening on campus. I think one of the sort of studio model that I pitched, where, you know, in which I said, we want to make the movies, we don't want to buy tickets to someone else's movie. One of the pieces there is that we want Notre Dame to be ubiquitous, right? As a source of new academic, faith, athletics, all sort of, you know, all of the content that makes Notre Dame unique, we want that to be a ubiquitous offering where we're giving our expanded community great experience. And so yes, having distinguished speakers and so on is a key part of that. Yes?
I'd like to get back to concept of the open entry course.
Yes.
I believe it was a article in the New York Times maybe a year or two ago, at Harvard, Yale, and about millions and millions of people mm-hmm. signed up for the course.
Yep.
But as time went on, percentage wise, only a very small
right.
percentage finished. And perhaps you could comment on that.
Yeah, well, that's a great question and a common observation. And I think that, and a lot of people, including Anand Agarwal, have responded to this question, which is that it depends on what your goals are and what you're looking for. If your goal is to make sure that 100% of the people who started the course complete the course, then by any standard, that's a problem, right? If your goal is to give people access to an educational experience that they will use and do with as they will, which might mean they dip in for 2 weeks, it might mean they complete the course and get a certificate, then that's a very different metric. And you're saying, look at all the people who have interacted with the university around some academic content, right? And maybe they'll circle back and so on, but it just depends on what you're looking for. So there was a leader in this field named George Siemens who said, does anyone, at a conference, and it was 6 months ago, he said, well, does anyone say, did you complete the library, right? Did you, you know, read all the books in the library, right? And I thought, well, that's sort of slightly provocative. That's an interesting way of thinking about, you know, what is it, the metric? There's this fund of information, this fund of knowledge, and we're organizing it in such a fashion that makes it, has integrity, so people know how to interact with it. So we call it a course. May not be a course, that may not even be the right metaphor for some of these things that we're building, right? So does that answer your question? Has anyone been waiting? Yes, please.
I was just gonna say that in human behavior, it's such that if you open the door, even if they don't complete it at that time, you'll never close that door for that person again. Mm-hmm. So it opens it up for life.
I think that's right. I mean, one of the great goals that online and digital learning makes possible, I mean, certainly doing great stuff on campus, right, is a crucial, I just want to be really clear, that's a crucial goal of ours, is to make sure that we continue to make this one of the world's great places to come and get an education. But that doesn't mean that we can't touch hundreds of thousands of people through you know, partnerships like the edX partnership, who will come in and maybe say, I had a week of this course and I couldn't continue because my life got busy, but I'm going back to it. And I remember, by the way, I'm grateful for Notre Dame for having taught me a little bit more about theology or about wireless and so forth. And then it becomes part of that virtuous cycle, right, where people value education more and so on. So, yes?
A few questions.
Okay.
First, logistical.
Sure.
Just as it relates to campus, can you give us some insight where this production did? I seem to recall that in the Crossroads project that there's a digital or a studio being built.
Digital Media Center, that's correct.
And I just wondered if this is part of that.
Yes.
Then secondly, going back to the Harvard, I remember reading somewhere, and I can't remember the exact numbers, if it was 200,000 people that signed up for a class at $100, or if it was 20,000 at $1,000. But when you look at the numbers there, mm-hmm. it overwhelmed them that they thought, oh my God,
right.
we're thinking about this differently now.
Sure.
When you think of leverage of $20 million potentially for one course, then you get to that curve and you say to yourself, well, could that allow us to maybe maintain that education level? So instead of having that exponential chart. So that's a question. Then it leads into the IP. Yeah, I think of professors that I know over years have put notes and continue to update. And so you get into some questions about intellectual property. And I just wondered if you could comment on that a bit. Just those three areas.
Yeah, the IP question is a big one. So let me talk about the revenue models. I think that we all want to make sure that we understand that, you know, the difference. What we do on open is and for free is going to be open and for free, and there are ways to, as it were, gather some optional secondary monetization so that we pay for that course, as it were, right? There's also enormous opportunity out there, and I think this is something we're really quite serious about, for building courses for professional development where there's a fee, right? Because there's demand and because it's a product that people value in their profession or in, you know, on campus and so forth. And so there is absolutely a model for the private paid course as well as the open online course, right? A private online course, which is behind a paywall, as well as the open course, which is for free, right? And so that, you know, we have to sort of manage, again, all of that, those become strategy questions, right? What do we think can and should be free? What do we think might be a paid offering that somebody wants, you know, wants and needs to pay for, and so forth? And that flows into a little bit, I don't want to hedge on the IP. I mean, I teach First Amendment, and the answer is always, it depends. But it depends, it is. If you think of it, it's always, it depends. It depends very much on what the channel of distribution is as far as what the IP considerations are. Things which happen on campus versus which we share with our alumni, which is versus paid versus open and free. There's a different IP picture. But you have to have everybody on board and knowing what they're getting into regardless and saying, I want it to be free. I don't care if people steal my PowerPoints, right? Or if you do, that's probably not, the open course probably isn't the right.
The students, right? Music, for example, college students, and it seems to be ubiquitous. Everybody's downloaded, but all of a sudden, then you get out into the work world.
Yep.
And you see networks now, movies, I mean, all distribution, whether it's learning, any type of media today.
Yeah, I mean, I know we've got to wrap up, but the things that I've been keeping my eye on, besides some of the vanguard institutions in higher ed, as far as building our strategy, that's Stanford, MIT, Harvard, chiefly among them, and a couple of international private equity markets, and the media industries. So media, private equity and VC, and then the content distribution, so Amazon, Netflix, the film industry, et cetera, how their newspapers, how those industries are thinking about content distribution with a broadband play fully in mind.
How about the logistics? Where are we
doing? So the Crossroads Center, the Digital Media Center, is a big part of it. We have studios and facilities and teams now which are sort of scattered about on campus. So we're able to kind of have a virtual organization, but the Crossroads will be a really sort of central hub for a lot of this work. Yeah.
I have three pieces of good news for you. The first is that I know Eddie will stay on and answer questions for a while after we, as we're breaking the group experience. This is another part of the new learning
strategy.
The second is that indeed we do each week record Saturday Scholars when we have it, and it goes up on the web. So another part of digital learning is that, of course, you can tell people who weren't here today, if they want to find out what's going on in this world, look it up on the Saturday Scholars website, and you'll see exactly what you've just been doing. And third, perhaps the most important news of all, the lights are back on outside and the restrooms are now operational. Thank you to Elliott.